Liz Pomfret, who's our speaker today, is a professor of surgery at Tufts University, chair of the Department of Transplant Surgery at the Lahey Clinic, and Liz graduated from Boston University School of Medicine, the MD-PhD program, completed a residency at New England Deaconess, fellowship in multi-organ transplant and hepatobiliary surgery at the Beth Israel Deaconess. And then she went for additional training to Hamburg, Germany, where she worked under Dr. Chris Brolsch. In fact, Liz and I were sort of talking about when we first met, and we think that we probably first met not in Hamburg, but in Essen, when we were both visiting Dr. Brolsch's program and for a conference. Liz Pomfret led the team that performed the first New England region's first adult-to-adult living donor liver transplant, and that was done in 1998. In 1999, Dr. Pomfret joined the Lahey Clinic, where she developed their medical center's program in adult living donor transplant, which has emerged as the largest living donor adult-to-adult program in the United States. The programs, perhaps in Japan and South Korea, have a higher volume, but this is the highest U.S. volume. Liz continues to do transplants of liver and kidney, and also does hepatobiliary surgery, liver, bile ducts, pancreas, particularly for tumors of those organs. She's on the board of UNOS at the moment, is treasurer of the International Liver Transplant Society. Remember, our first speaker in the series was Frank Delmonico, who is president this year, but Liz controls the money. So without any further ado, let me introduce Liz Pomfret, who's going to talk about should living donors be used for patients with hepatocellular cancer. Liz, thanks for joining us.
Just by way of introduction, I just want to start with a few pieces of information about just liver transplantation for hepatocellular carcinoma. Coming here to speak about any aspect of liver transplantation is like bringing coals to Newcastle. You certainly are well aware of the pioneering history that began here in terms of live donor liver transplantation and the fact that the first United States, anyway, live donor liver transplant occurred here at the University of Chicago in 1989, and Peter Whittington and Christoph Brolsch are two of the people who are in the brochure that's to your right, and this is the first patient who, as I understand it, has graduated from college and continues to enjoy a long, healthy life. So what we're talking about today is really kind of when you think about where live donor liver transplantation started, taking a small portion of a healthy person's, usually the parent's liver, and giving it to a baby. I mean, we're really in a whole nother domain right now when we're addressing adult to adult live donor transplantation and the amount of liver volume that would be needed to be successful at that. So Dr. Sigler and I were part of a team that participated in a international consensus conference on liver transplantation for hepatocellular carcinoma that was held in December 2010 in Zurich. And our question that we were asked to explore was, should we use living donor grafts for patients with hepatocellular carcinoma, the ethical considerations? So this consensus conference really dealt with all aspects of liver transplantation for hepatocellular carcinoma, and ours was really just to look at these ethical considerations. And when you look at the first seven liver transplants that were performed by Dr. Starzl way back in the 60s and 63, you can see that of the first seven, the vast majority of them were for cancers, for liver cancers, and didn't do particularly well. So it didn't get off to a great start. And just by way of background, since not everybody might be familiar with the details of liver transplantation, for various indications. At this point, hepatocellular carcinoma, There's over a million people worldwide who have hepatocellular carcinoma, and it's about the fourth to fifth leading cause of death in the United States, with about greater than 20,000 deaths in the United States occurring. The vast majority of these cancers occur in the setting of cirrhosis. And the incidence within cirrhotic patients is about 1 to 6% incidence of hepatocellular carcinoma in patients with cirrhosis. The main reason for cirrhosis at this point is chronic hepatitis C in the United States. It's anticipated that the number of hepatitis C-related tumors will double over the next 20 years. There's multiple treatments that are available, but liver transplantation offers the only potential cure for both the cancer and the underlying liver disease, the underlying cirrhosis. The Milan criteria, which I'll talk just very briefly, is a set of criteria that came out of Milan, Italy, that it was used to stage hepatocellular carcinomas and really set the stage for liver transplantation to be widely accepted as a curative treatment for early stage hepatocellular carcinoma. So the impact of cirrhosis, normally if you have a person who has a tumor in their liver and they have a normal liver, you can resect up to 70%, even 75% of a healthy person's liver, and as long as that remaining 25 to 30% is normal, it will regenerate. You don't have that luxury in patients with cirrhosis because you don't have normal liver that's going to be able to regenerate. So the impact of cirrhosis on resection as a treatment for hepatocellular carcinoma is reduced by the fact that the hepatic reserve influences the postoperative morbidity and mortality. You technically can't do a lot of these operations because you don't have the capacity to have that person regenerate properly. There's also the issue of compromised surgical margins and the issue of the fact that the whole entire field of the cirrhotic liver is really a tumorigenic field that has a potential for multifocal tumorigenesis. So the Milan criteria, because this does have relevance in terms of what we're going to talk about with live donation, the Milan criteria is a set of criteria that was developed and published in New England Journal of Medicine in 1996. A remarkably small group of patients. There was only 48 patients in the whole study, and it's really dictated how we treat hepatocellular carcinoma in terms of liver transplantation from that point forward. But it's either having one lesion that's less than 5 centimeters or 2 to 3 lesions, but none can be greater than 3 centimeters. And there has to be an absence of gross invasion into any of the hepatic blood vessels or absence of extrahepatic spread. So if you fit this criteria, if you're a patient with cirrhosis and you have a hepatocellular carcinoma that fits the Milan criteria, there has been a system developed within the deceased donor organ allocation system that allows for you to get extra points to get priority on the waiting list. Because the fact is you're not going to die of your cirrhosis. You're going to die of your tumor becoming out of bounds. But the reason why this was adopted was that the data showed that if you use patients who met this criteria, who had small tumors and treated them with a transplant, they actually did just as well as patients who got a transplant for a non-cancer reason. So they had very good patient survival and a less than 10% chance of recurrence. And further studies that have gone on subsequently have also demonstrated that. So the general quote is that there's about an 85% overall survival with a less than 10% or a 10% chance of recurrence for tumors that fit Milan criteria. So as I said, patients don't die of their liver failure, so they had to get extra priority because the organ allocation for deceased donor liver transplants is arranged by sickest first. And so there's a score, a MELD score that's used, which is a composite of this big mathematical equation that uses your bilirubin, your INR, and your creatinine to stratify patients along the spectrum of disease, with 7 being the least likely to die and 40 being the most likely to die. And so patients with hepatocellular carcinoma usually have very low MELD scores. So they don't die of their liver failure. What they die of is that their tumor, as it grows larger, and you can see the cutoff here is 3 centimeters, the likelihood of dropping off the list because you fell outside the Milan criteria increases exponentially as the size of that tumor increases. And so a whole set of extra points were devised starting, you know, back when the MELD score was first put in play in 2002. And it's been ratcheted down three different times because we realized that the patients with hepatocellular carcinoma were getting way too much priority. So we had assigned a score that seemed reasonable, but it was kind of a, you know, pick a number out of a hat, and realized that it was too high. Too many patients with hepatocellular carcinoma were getting transplanted as opposed to if you didn't have hepatocellular carcinoma. So that's the way the deceased donor organ pool works. So now we're going to kind of switch gears to what our mission was. So to arrive at the answers to the question, our committee examined four different aspects of these ethical considerations. So the first question was, why is live donation necessary at all? And is it different for patients with hepatocellular carcinoma versus having end-stage liver disease from something else? What is double equipoise and how is it affected by the diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma? Is paired exchange appropriate if one or both recipients have hepatocellular carcinoma? And what are some of the other considerations? So unlike other aspects of this consensus conference where people were using level one data to decide on recommendations, you can imagine that, you know, discussing ethics and double equipoise and whatnot, we weren't dealing with level one, but really more like level five expert opinion. And quite frankly, much of the presentation that we ended up putting together came from just the debates and discussions that we had as a team discussing this. So the first question was, why is live donation necessary at all? And is it different for patients with hepatocellular carcinoma? Well, as I showed you, it's well established, even in countries that have adequate deceased donor, and I'd hardly call the United States adequate deceased donor, but have plentiful deceased donor transplants as compared to, say, Asia or some other countries, that live donation is in fact appropriate, even in that setting, due to the overall shortage of organs and the fact that not every person awaiting transplant will get an organ. And there is certainly geographic disparity, but in all areas of the country, we know that there are people waiting on the waiting list who will die waiting because an organ was not available. We also know, as I just showed you, that tumors within the Milan criteria exhibit low recurrence and excellent survival after surgery. And we also know that organ allocation policies prioritize for the deceased donor organs for patients with hepatocellular carcinomas that meet Milan criteria. But when we're talking about live donor transplants, we're not disadvantaging any other people. We're talking about someone coming with their own organ. So really, these organ allocation policies for prioritization don't really have meaning in terms of the live donation. Donor safety is clearly of paramount importance in live donor liver transplantation. And yet, living donor complications and deaths occur even in the most experienced hands and most experienced centers. So, as far as the donor safety issue, there was another international consensus conference held in Vancouver in 2008 that really established the practices for all living organ donation that was extra-renal. There was a separate conference that had been held in Amsterdam just specifically looking at living kidney donation. So, in this Vancouver forum, a lot of both medical guidelines, psychosocial guidelines for evaluation, treatment, follow-up, conduct of standards of how to conduct the operation were discussed, but also the ethical issues were discussed. And we came to an agreement in that conference that living liver donation should only be performed if the risk to the donor is justified by the expectation of an acceptable outcome in a recipient. So that was one of the first premises. So just because you have a living donor doesn't mean that it's reasonable to do that if you're looking at an outcome with a recipient that's absolutely dismal. Indications for live donor liver transplant should be the same as the indications that we've established for deceased donor transplants, with the exception of institutionally approved protocols, so things There are certain other kinds of liver tumors that don't have as good outcomes, cholangiocarcinomas, but there are programs that do have institutionally IRB-approved protocols that they're doing, and so we're saying that in those circumstances, living donors should be considered as reasonable organs to be used, and that we certainly would hope that if we're going to use a living donor organ for a living donor liver transplant, that live donor liver transplantation should offer an overall advantage to the recipient as compared to waiting on the waiting list. And certainly the multi-center NIH trial called A2All has demonstrated that patients who come forward with a potential living donor and have that from the time of evaluation and have that living donor done at an experienced center do the best of any group. The patients, they do better than the patients who have to wait on the wait, who have to wait for a deceased donor transplant, and certainly better than patients who sit on the waiting list, and they do better than patients who go to an inexperienced live donor center. So that advantage is seen both in the post-transplant better outcomes, but it's also seen from the time of being listed to the time of transplantation. So that's certainly one of the advantages of live donor liver transplantation. The reality is that even in the most experienced hands, there have been donor deaths. In 2006, Jim Trotter reported 13 living donor deaths that were definitely related, so it gave an overall mortality rate of, this was part of the A2All study, so these were all really right lobe donors, gave a mortality rate for living donor right lobe liver transplantation of somewhere between 0.15 and 0.2%. Ringe and Strong had a publication in 2008 that identified 33 live donor deaths, of which 21 were thought to be related directly to the operation. And so that gave an overall mortality rate of somewhere between 0.15 and 0.3. But we know that it may be as high as 0.5 when using the right liver as opposed to left liver. There is a paper that our group has published of a worldwide survey of near-miss events that is coming out in liver transplantation that shows that this number is actually up to about 36 worldwide, and that if you look at where the deaths have occurred, the deaths tend to occur after a center has done somewhere on the order of about 200. So the real mortality rate is probably closer to this. If you look at just absolute total numbers done in the world and how many deaths there have been, that's where you get this kind of discrepancy. So in addition to these publications, there have been two additional deaths. One actually happened at our center in May 2010, and the other one in Colorado. So we know that there is an absolute mortality risk that's associated with right lobe donation. Left lobe donation has a lower mortality, but still has the possibility of having a catastrophic event. We know that the morbidity is definitely related to the amount of liver tissue that you remove. That's been demonstrated in a number of different studies, and that the overall morbidity rate is about 10% for left lobe donors and somewhere between 33 to 40% for right lobe donors. Most of those are minor complications, but about 10% of complications in the right lobe donors do require another intervention. So those would be stratified then as major complications. There is no central reporting agency for living donor complications. The only thing that you must do is you must report a donor death or a donor who is being listed for transplant with the with UNOS. But otherwise, there is no central registry for reporting near-miss events, complications, or anything like that. So we really don't have a good handle on what the real risks are to donors. So if we accept that live donor liver transplantation is indicated for non-hepatocellular cancer liver disease, then it should be an indication for hepatocellular cancer. And then the debate really revolves around the relative merits of using live donor liver transplantation outside the accepted criteria. And so that's really where we focused most of the discussion. So tumors outside of MacLean. So question number two, so our answer to question number one is, you know, is there a need for live donor transplantation in hepatocellular carcinoma? Yes. And is it different because it's hepatocellular carcinoma? Really only we get to the the ethical challenge when we're going outside of the accepted criteria. So question number two, what is double equipoise and how is it affected by the diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma? And a lot of the work in this section of the presentation was done, in fact, by Dr. Sigler and his colleagues here at the University of Chicago. So we know that as long as there's a disparity between the supply and the demand of deceased donor organs, that organ allocation for deceased donor organs really has to follow a system of distribution that's based on ethical principles of utility, justice, and equity. So utility, if we had a system based purely, an allocation system for deceased donor organs based purely on utility, we would just stratify the organs by who has the best survival. And that's not what we do right now. Justice would imply that all candidates would have equal access to transplant, and equity is it would ensure that the organ allocation policy is applied equally and that similar recipients have equal priority. We know that there is not equity. There's definite disparity that occurs in the United States depending on where you live. You are more or less likely to receive a deceased donor organ. And we know that that exists right now. And it's more accentuated when you start parsing out hepatocellular carcinoma versus non-hepatocellular carcinoma. So in living donation, the ethical principles of justice and equity used for the deceased donor allocation scheme just don't apply, since the recipient's not competing with other patients who are listed for organ transplant. Now, you could say that it sort of has an indirect effect in that if you transplant someone with a living donor organ, you're allowing there to be another organ available for somebody who doesn't have a living donor. But for the purposes of our discussion, these principles really don't apply if you're producing your own donor. So living donor transplant recipients, if anything, you could say benefit all patients sitting on the waiting list since they're eliminating one more person off of the list. So the concept of double equipoise, which I'm sure many of you are familiar with here since this is something that's been well described by Dr. Sigler and many of you in this room, describes the balance between the recipient's survival benefit with or without a live donor transplant and the probability of a donor mortality. So the risk-benefit analysis then for live donor liver transplantation isn't just confined to the individual donor and the recipient, but it's this balancing of the donor's risk of potentially dying or having a catastrophic outcome, here we just use death, versus the recipient benefit. And double equipoise suggests that there is clearly an area of excessive donor risk and an area of unacceptably low recipient benefit. And so ethically unacceptable for living donation to undergo an operation would be if we jacked that mortality risk from what we know to be the one that we typically quote, that it's under 0.5%, and said, okay, if we were looking at a mortality risk of between 0.5% and 1% or greater than 1%, and would what would then be the risks that were reasonable for a donor to incur based on recipient benefit? So we also know that there are situations of donor-recipient balance that appear to be ethically acceptable. An adult donor providing a liver to a pediatric recipient, that's really well established at this point, and there's not much that people usually have ethical problems with, since most of the time that adult donor is either the parent or closely related to that pediatric recipient. But that's not the case in the adult to adult. In fact, the most common donor category for adult to adult live donor liver transplantation is children to their parents. So literally the exact opposite of what you see with pediatric. So here the donor risks are for donating a portion of liver to a baby, usually it's about 25% of the liver volume. We know the risks are well defined, they're small risks, the recipient benefit is high, we're transplanting a baby with a whole life ahead of them, and we've got history here of since 1989 of showing that these kids do great. In fact, you just saw pictures of a patient from your own center who is well into adulthood. So while there are certainly two extremes where you can sit and say, you know, low risk to donor, great outcome for patient versus higher risk to donor with a lousy outcome for patient. So there's those extremes. The part that sits in the middle is where we have this zone of ethical uncertainty. And that's the area that we decided we were going to focus on. So what we wanted to focus on are what are the minimal benefits to the recipient that warrant the risk and the use of the living donor, and how is the use of the living donor for extended indications and marginal recipient benefit justified? And so what we did was, actually I'm not sure who gets credit for this graph, Dr. Ziegler, within your group, but I know that this came from Dr. Ziegler's group, was putting together this graph of showing if we looked at what's ethically acceptable and we put in these mortality risks, a donor risk of dying of 0.5% versus a donor risk of dying of 1%, then we know that there's a piece here where, you know, you're kind of in this zone that might shift the curve one way or the other. And then there's clearly, you know, the unacceptable, where the recipient benefit is so low and the donor risk is so high that really anyone would agree that this is an unreasonable thing to do. And the pediatric patient, for instance, where the recipient benefit is huge and the donor risk is small, you know, these are those two extremes that we were talking about. And now we're really going to focus on this balance between the two. So our third question was, what is double equipoise and how is it affected by the diagnosis of hepatocellular carcinoma? So we said, well, in this area, we've got to take into account some of the issues related to the view from the donor, which, although it's affected by emotional attachment, presumably to the recipient, is, you know, important, and we'll discuss that more when we get into specific scenarios. Although we might judge the risk-benefit ratio to be inappropriate in some situations, our duty as doctors is to advise the donor and the recipient pair of the inherent risks and potential benefits so that they can make an informed decision. So it's really not for us as the physicians to impose our own values, but to really guide the discussion so that the donor and recipient can then come upon a correct decision for them. And so this is where we then started to talk about individual case scenarios and how this double equipoise works. So the first is the case of, say, a 45-year-old mother of three children who has hepatocellular carcinoma that is outside the Milan criteria and outside of an extension of the Milan criteria, which is the UCSF criteria, so clearly not eligible for extra points for a deceased donor organ, gets treatment for her hepatocellular carcinoma to try to shrink it down to acceptable criteria. That's what downsizing is, downstaging. So if you just look at purely on her tumor biology and whatnot, she's got low recipient benefit. But the donor in this case is her husband, who's willing to do anything to extend or obviously save his wife's life, and he understands the risks. So here you've got a young woman, bad tumor, three kids, husband, let's say he's a reasonably intelligent person who understands the risks, doesn't really care that his wife is in this, you know, bad biology thing. So if we stratified the original kind of risk balance ratio, we'd say, well, she's got low recipient benefit, donor risk is average because he's an otherwise healthy guy, and that is what would then skew this discussion to say, well, this is an ethically reasonable thing to do, because under these circumstances where you're talking about this particular situation, even though her outcomes are not thought to be that good as compared to patients within Milan or with better biology tumor, in this case, the benefit derived from the husband who understands and has an average risk to having an extension of her life or saving her life is worth it. Now, if we change that a little bit and we say, okay, well, what about if we're talking about a 70-year-old gentleman, Mr. Jones, who has hepatocellular carcinoma beyond the UCSF criteria? So again, poor biology and thought to be low recipient benefit if we just look at this and his age. But he's got his loving 20-year-old granddaughter who wants to be a liver donor for him. And so here again, he's not impacting the overall allocation scheme for deceased donor transplantation. And there's certainly been many people who have argued, who are we to say if he shows up and his granddaughter wants to do this for him, who are we to say no? But if we look at this and say, okay, we've got low recipient benefit, and we're talking about a 20-year-old girl with a right lobe donation and potential, you know, a 0.5% chance of her dying, not to mention 35% chance of morbidity associated with the procedure. If we stratify that risk, we feel that this really moves into this unacceptable zone. So this is, you know, obviously up to individual judgment, because, you know, you can certainly have very passionate arguments, especially if you're these two people, about what's reasonable and what's not reasonable. But I think that this is a way of helping to frame the discussion, taking into account that even though the person is not impacting the overall deceased donor pool, because you're coming in with your own donor, there are things to be considered here that really, I think, do need to be considered in order to ethically move ahead with this. And so I would put this into the ethically unacceptable category. So question three is paired exchange appropriate if one or both recipients have hepatocellular carcinoma? So let's just talk about what paired exchange is. Let's consider that Mr. Smith wants to donate to his wife, Mrs. Smith, but he's blood group B and she's blood group A. And Mr. Jones, the 70-year-old, is blood group B, but his granddaughter is blood group A, doing this swap. This goes on very commonly in the kidney world, less so in the liver world. But the question is it acceptable for a paired donor exchange to take place with Mr. Smith donating to Mr. Jones and then Mr. Jones's granddaughter donating to Mrs. Smith? And in this situation, there's the potential benefit of the ABO incompatibility being solved, and also the benefit of improving the size match. So you've got the 20-year-old girl who's donating to another woman versus her 70-year-old grandfather, who, you know, may or may not have size issues, and closer in age too. So you've got the 20-year-old donating to the 45-year-old versus to her 70-year-old grandfather. And so we discussed this quite a bit and said, well, you know, because of the fact that, you know, you had low benefit for both recipients, if you stratify their risks of recurrence and outcomes with the kinds of tumors that they have, you know, they're certainly, both recipients were equally kind of poor recipient benefit, poor risk. But in this case, if you're talking about now the 20-year-old donating to the 45-year-old lady, and the gentleman who was the husband, presumably, let's say he's about the same age, donating to the 70-year-old gentleman, you know, you're talking about risks that, in fact, maybe because of the size, the 20-year-old girl wouldn't have to donate a right lobe, but a smaller amount of liver tissue, a left lobe. And so then, you know, maybe you could certainly make an argument here for saying that this is ethically reasonable, because now you've kind of evened out some of these issues which made it more risky for the donor, and the benefit really didn't change much for the recipients. And then finally, we discuss, well, what other ethical considerations should there be? What should we do when a deceased donor candidate dies in the operating room? You know, we have an allocation scheme for that. That liver then, if it hasn't been contaminated, gets reallocated to the next patient on the list. We don't necessarily have something like that in place. Individual centers may discuss this with patients. Our center does. But if if the recipient of a living donor graft dies in the operating room or becomes untransplantable, doesn't you don't think that they're going to survive, and the liver lobe has already been removed from the donor, you now have a situation of an orphan graft. So in all of our living donor operations, I always consent each one of the donors saying, if, God forbid, your recipient were to die and we've already got your liver lobe out, under that circumstance, would you allow us to transplant that into another patient? And so far, I've never had any donor say no. They've always said, oh, of course, yes. But now, clearly, it would not go through the normal allocation scheme. I mean, this would be, you'd have to have a circumstance where somebody's in the hospital and it's the right blood type and that amount of liver tissue would be reasonable. And you've got a transplant team that's able to, after this catastrophe, suddenly switch gears and start transplanting this, you know, lobe into somebody else. So there's a lot of ifs here. And then there's the question of, you know, if the donor operation isn't totally completed, okay, so you've got the liver, say, split, which is this hepardivism, you know, what do you do with that donor? So there's lots of different arguments. I mean, should you just take that lobe out? Because, especially if the bile duct's already been transected, because reconstructing that bile duct might set that person up for subsequent problems with bile duct complications and future surgeries. So there are people who say, well, you know, at that point, yeah, I think you should take the lobe out. Either way, you'd complete the operation. Or others that would say, no, if the lobe hasn't come out, even if the bile duct's been divided, you should reconstruct the bile duct and leave it in the donor. And I think that that's certainly still an area that there's no consensus on at this point. So finally, other ethical considerations. We discussed that all living donors should have the possibility of, you know, a recipient death on the table discussed at the time of the donor surgical procedure, so that if, in fact, you do find yourself in this circumstance with an orphan graft, that liver could potentially be allocated. This has occurred. It's occurred in a couple of different institutions. And when it first occurred, there hadn't been any previous discussion with the donor about this. And so the lobe had to be discarded. So in conclusion, our group then ended up kind of summarizing with that hepatocellular carcinoma, certainly within Milan criteria, is indicated for deceased donor or live donor transplantation. So there was no disagreement about that. But that, unlike deceased donor transplant, living donor is not governed by utility concerns that we describe as double equipoise. And I mean, is governed by utility concerns that we describe as double equipoise, and not by equity and justice. So we're dealing with a different situation than the deceased donor, where it's impacting an entire population of people. So one could argue that living liver donors, by reducing the number of people who are waiting on the waiting list, actually enhance everybody's chances on the waiting list, because you've just removed another person off of the waiting list. So these typical ethical considerations really aren't totally germane when we're discussing live donation, but we certainly do know that this issue of donor risk to recipient benefit has to be considered. So since live donation is governed by utility and not by justice and equity, we could certainly support that you can utilize live donor organs for extended criteria liver tumors beyond the acceptable criteria for a deceased donor, like, for instance, beyond Milan, beyond UCSF, because in reaching a double equipoise decision for the donor and the recipient, it is acceptable to include not only the mortality and morbidity data, but also the quality of life and the psychosocial and the social considerations that are related to those two parties. So, you know, I think that when we get into these individual cases and discuss what is the risk benefit, for instance, you know, I would say that for, you know, my sibling or certainly my daughter or my husband, that, you know, you could really be looking at a really dismal outcome with them, and I would still consider that to be a reasonable thing to do because I understand the risk associated with the operation, and the benefit to me as the donor would be enormous if that person's life was saved. So I just want to thank everybody, and I'm happy to discuss any questions.
Thank you very much. So I'll just start off the discussion for a little bit. So let's put a scenario together that a patient with an HCC that's actually within Milan criteria and his MELD score is now 31. I don't know, that would be at least competitive mm-hmm. here, probably similar in Boston. And now a living donor comes forward and says, I'd really like to be a living donor for this person. What would you tell that donor and that recipient where now he's going to probably get a deceased donor liver relatively soon?
Mm-hmm. So this scenario comes up all the time, actually, and what we typically will do is to work that donor up in parallel with the patient sitting on the list. So for blood group O or blood group A in New England, probably similar to here, you'd have to go through 3 MELD cycles, at least 9 to 12 months, before that patient would be high enough score to be really within, you know, the possibility of getting a deceased donor organ. So depending on where that person sits, you know, when that live donor comes forward, if we've moved along and we're ready to go and we still know that this person likely, because they're sitting in with a MELD score in the 20s in their blood group O, we would go ahead with the live donor transplant. If they're up higher than that, we've certainly had circumstances where the recipient has gotten the deceased donor organ really at the same time that we were ready to do the live donor transplant and have canceled the live donor transplant on the day of. I think that when you're talking about somebody coming forward late in the game as a living donor, when the person's already up in that 30, 31, that's where you have to sit there and say, you have to really look at this and say, who are we talking about? Who is the donor? What's the risks associated with this donor? You know, are we talking about somebody who's extremely young, you know, where you're worried, you know, you're looking at a 20-year-old person versus somebody who might be older? So all of these come into play. Are we talking about the person's child? Are we talking about the person's sibling? You know,
yeah, I mean, whatever,
you know,
sibling.
I think it does matter. Right. It does matter in the sense that, you know, all of these different components come in. So if you've got somebody who you say, okay, you're not talking about, you know, somebody who's young in college, you're pulling them out of school, you're doing this kind of thing, he's likely going to be transplanted in this period of time, you know, you might say, let's wait. Now the problem is that when we have had recipients who, for whatever reason, we've waited and said, you know what, you're close to the top of the list, we think you're going to get a transplant, and God forbid they die before that, the worst group of depressed people that we've dealt with are these donors who had been evaluated, got up to the point, made that decision that they were going to do it, and it didn't work out. Because our tendency as human beings is to always think that if it had worked out, it would have been perfect. You know, that if we had gone, if only I had gone through. Now, most of the time, these scenarios have happened because there's a delay just because of family dynamics. You know, that so-and-so wants to wait until school break, and, you know, that's in December, and dad has a GI bleed in early November, and then becomes untransplantable and whatever. So I think it's a difficult thing to discuss, and I've definitely been leaned more toward going ahead with the live donor transplant, because I've also seen the opposite side of this, of the people who you did evaluate them, and then they're plagued for the rest of their life thinking, if only we had done this, everything would have been fine. Even though, of course, we have no way of knowing that everything would have been fine, you know, by any means. But I think that that's been particularly damaging.
Thank you very much. I have concerns regarding the double equipoise situation, because there's no quantification that we as so-called medical scientists understand. Is there a way to put a number on a risk, say by standard gamble or something like that, where you could actually get a better estimate of what the relationship of outcome for the recipient who you said has a low benefit and risk for the donor who has no benefit and potential disaster, especially in the case of the mother with three children whose husband is the potential donor. You could have three parentless children. Mm-hmm. And I just don't know. I realize that there's not a box drawn around all of this. Is there a way to construct a box, though, that you can have a higher degree of certainty?
I'm sure that there are great mathematicians who could come up with some sort of equation. I'm sure you could stratify, because we kind of have it on the recipient side, you know, with MELD score and whatnot. You can stratify based on the features of their tumor, their disease, et cetera, what you think their likelihood. There's lots of different scores out there now where you can predict based on the features of the size of the tumor, the pathology, et cetera, what their recurrence rate's going to be, what their likelihood of dying is going to be. So the recipient side, I think, yeah, you could probably do a pretty good job of stratifying that. Right. And then I think on the donor side, that's where it gets tough. And that's where, you know, but I would imagine that, you know, with a very smart mathematician, computer person, that you could put in a whole host of different things. Age, you know, relationship, all these different things. You know, the different risk factors associated with just, you know, an anatomic variabilities and all of this kind of thing, because here we are splitting this liver. I mean, some donors are easier to do than other donors, left lobe, right lobe, that you could probably create some sort of mathematical equation that gave you a, I don't know, living donor benefit risk index or something, you know, where you could.
So actually, when we came up with a living donor, the living donor double equipoise concept, we didn't really know the risks for, especially for right lobes on the donors. And it was more to try to, number one, define what that risk was and determine if there was a relationship between that risk and the willingness then to proceed with a recipient. And so now we have better information in regards to the specific donor risk in general. And so, you know, maybe it's time to think about more specific of that risk index. The other thing that, you know, it's perhaps even more important now that we have some relationship there is to think about, it's relatively easy when you're talking about a society that doesn't have any cadaveric or has essentially zero cadaveric options. And then that line goes a lot steeper, right? Mm-hmm. The real issue in the States is the relatively randomness of donor offers, and how that then imposes its probabilities on that graph, which I think is a huge issue. Mark wanted to make a comment
about Ed's question. When we wrote the original New England Journal paper in 1989 on estimating risk for donors who would give, in those days we originally started with a left lobe. The first three or four cases, we came up with an estimate of 0.5% to 1% donor mortality. That is, the procedure had only been done once or twice before in the world, in Australia and a few operations in Brazil, without any donors dying. But we thought that in a large enough series, you'd get to that 0.5% to 1%. At that point, and today, there's no societal determination about what the outer limit is for donor risk. I mean, nobody has come down with a hard number. And in fact, the data that Liz showed and that Mike has just commented on, that there have been 33 or 36 deaths around the world in the adult procedure generating this roughly 0.5% mortality number, is all of that is relatively new information. We didn't have it before. We now know for the pediatric operation, which is the left lateral segment, that the mortality risk is much, much lower. I mean, probably the order of 1 in 1,500, 1 in 2,000 deaths for a pediatric donor. But this adult donor we didn't have. Well, now that we've got it, as Mike said and Liz showed, I think we can move more quickly towards this quantification that you're asking for. We couldn't have done it 2-3 years ago before the data was presented, in part because there's no international registry, and these cases do occur, thank goodness, in real isolation. I mean, they happen at the best centers often, and it takes a while for them to be picked up and reported in the literature or sometimes at conferences. I think we're working towards that. This question of recipient benefit is much harder to quantify. That is, how you figure out, you can quantify it easily at the extreme. Someone whose death is likely within a month or two, whatever you do, you're not going to do it.
Well, there's a benefit. But there's a potential benefit there that's actually more measurable. That's the claim.
But in the cases beyond the extremes, it gets really tough to come up with a recipient benefit that's in that borderline area.
I was just going to ask, sort of along the lines of the analysis, you presented two cases, and I guess I'm just wondering, in policy terms, how do you prevent permissive centers from drawing a very thin ethical line and making sure that what you worked on as a group is enforced?
Well, it's an excellent question. I think, you know, these are not patients. The recipients would not be eligible for priority points for hepatocellular carcinoma because they're outside the acceptable criteria, but they could still get a liver if it's been turned down by everybody. I mean, they could still potentially get a liver, and that's certainly one strategy that's used all the time. I mean, you know, in terms of it's usually not a particularly great liver necessarily that's been turned down by an entire region, and that it's able to be used in a patient who's that far down on the list, because usually these people would have very, very low MELD scores. But so there is that possibility. The issue of using live donors in this setting, I think, is self-regulated in the United States and Western Europe, in the sense that a living donor death is such an in the liver world. I mean, we don't see it become as quite as publicized in the, although there's kidney donor deaths, you know, that occur every year, many of them. Not well, many, but I mean relative to livers. But the number of total kidney transplants, you know, is so much larger than the number of living donor liver transplants being done. But the reality is that when live donation first started, there was a huge increase in the number of living donor livers that were done. That kind of topped out in 2002. And then between the MELD scoring system and a very highly publicized death at Mount Sinai, you saw that number decrease, and it's been decreasing ever since. Every year it has decreased further. So I think that you're just less likely to see programs at this point, after seeing how devastating a donor death has been to the program, to the surgeon, to clearly the family. But I mean, you know, looking at that, you're not seeing programs wanting to do these very extreme cases in the United States or Western Europe.
Thanks. Thanks for your presentation. I have to confess to being somebody who's got some skepticism about living donors for hepatic transplant to begin with. And so maybe this isn't necessarily directed toward you, but even toward Mark and others here. But here's the kind of thing that troubles me. I mean, you know, suppose we said, you know, volunteer for a medical experiment in which 1 out of 200 of you is going to be shot, ground up into a serum that would, you know, cure 1,000 people, save 1,000 lives. I mean, you know, at least I would have trouble suggesting that I'd say a patient should go ahead who's healthy should go ahead and do that. I mean, it does satisfy double equipoise, you know, in terms of the risks. But I'm not even sure going to Afghanistan in the army is as high a risk as this. You know, the difference may be, you know, that it's for a particular, you're willing to take that risk for a particular person. I'm, you know, again, you know, the question is, are we being too paternalistic by not allowing people to take that kind of risk? But it does seem high to me, even for relatives, even for a, you know, a more than one relative, if that were possible. And maybe one other way of getting to this question of what's driving this is, you know, would you consider having somebody do an altruistic living donor hepatic transplant? And is just the fact that it's a relative part of what's driving taking what I consider to be pretty high risks?
Mm-hmm. Well, those are excellent points, and that's really the heart of the debate. Of, you know, live donor liver transplantation is any risk of this magnitude reasonable? I think that everyone within the transplant community and within who is supportive of live donor liver transplantation all feel that clearly the best thing that we should be trying to achieve is to take less tissue out of the donor and have it be sufficient for the recipient and flip the risks toward the recipient side of things. Now that could be a whole other discussion. Okay.
It is next week. John Roberts
okay.
is here.
Okay, so good. So John Roberts will go through that whole thing and, you know, discuss whether that's, you know, the way the risk should move. And certainly I think the field is more moving in that direction. I don't think that there's necessarily this issue of relatives per se, but in the liver transplant world so far, there's definitely been altruistic liver donors. There definitely have been. In fact, one donor death, a suicide, was an altruistic donor from a few years ago, left lateral segment donor. So, I mean, very low risk. He had apparently planned to do this the entire time because he was found at some camping site in Montana or something with his suicide note, you know, where he had taken all of his Percocets, 2 months or so out from donation, where he said, I knew I was going to do this, and before I killed myself, I wanted to do something good. So, okay, so that obviously, you know, kind of blew the lid off of a lot of things. But so there have been, but I would say that the appetite for moving in that direction is been pretty low, especially, you know, given the risks associated with the donation. We've certainly considered it in our program, and I've had actually brought it to our ethics committee and said that if we were going to do it, I would only want to be looking at a left lobe, so 10% morbidity, probably more on the order of 0.1% mortality, so lower risk to donor, but still a risk, that's what I would want to do. And it was very interesting because the ethics committee came back to me and said, well, why would you do that? I mean, you know, if somebody wanted to do this, why wouldn't you, you know, open up the possibility to as many patients as possible and use the right lobes like you're using, you know, another. So I think the it's an argument that can go both ways. One very interesting thing that we found in our cohort of patients, we've done about 250 of these adult-to-adult live donor transplants, is, and we published a paper on it on the ambivalent donor, is these related relatives, and what we found was the group who tended to be more likely ambivalent, but still went through with donation. So they had no question they were going to do it. Was brother to brother and son to father. And it was very interesting because it was like, you know, you see that Venus and Mars and all this other. It's really interesting in evaluating, I've probably evaluated about 700 donors so far. Women do not donate to people they don't like. They don't do it. They don't do it. Men will donate to people they don't like. So they can have a brother who has always been the screw up, never really liked him, whatever, and they'll say, you know what, I feel a moral obligation to do it. I'm doing it for his kids. I'm doing it, and they can have very cogent, unemotional conversations with you about how they do not like their brother, but they're still going to do it. And, you know, when this first came up, it was kind of like disturbing, or son to father. The women, it's very interesting because she may not have liked her brother her whole life, but now she sort of talked herself into, you know, he always, you know, he had a lot of issues and a lot of problems, but he's a good person. The women do not walk into a donation saying, can't stand him, but I'm going to do it anyway. It's fascinating.
So a couple of things, Dan, and the way you framed your question is a little bit different than what we work, obviously,
no,
right?
There's a difference between
your question was, you're going to someone and doing this, right? Number one, they're coming to us and asking us.
Yeah.
Then the aspect is, you know, you said, you know, you're going to help 200 people or 2,000, whatever your number was, right? It's also, you know, if you would even say, of those, one of them is a loved family member who has the disease that you will cure, right? And frame it that way, even, you know, in the scenario that you said, would a little bit closer to what we're dealing with, right?
Yeah, that's why I was thinking the relationship part seems to be what it seems to me makes people willing to accept this kind of risk, or the medical community willing to accept putting healthy people.
Well, they're asking us to do it in reality. I mean, because I'm sure at Liz's program and all the other ones, we actually try to make sure that they don't do it and know that they have other options.
Dan's question goes back to the beginning of organ transplant. In 1954, the first successful transplant was done in Boston under Dr. Moore's supervision, Francis Moore. And it was a living donation between two brothers. Within 3 years, Franny Moore took that situation to court to get approval by the Massachusetts court to do a living organ donation, because he already had qualms about it, even though it was the first time it had been done successfully. By the late 50s, Dr. Moore was writing on whether it was ever ethical to use one person to benefit another. So right from the, I mean, within 4 or 5 years of starting the program, there was serious debate at the Brigham, within that one program in the world that was doing it, about the kinds of questions that Dr. Solmezzi is now raising. It's quite clear that both in the United States and around the world, Western Europe and particularly in Asia, this practice has at least met the legal and ethical standards of 50 or 100 countries where living donation is done. As you've heard in earlier meetings here, a third of the kidneys in the United States derive from living donors on an annual basis. So this is pretty much an established and accepted practice. You can go back to the 50s and ask those questions again. It's legitimate to do, but recognize that the fundamental question has largely been settled in many of the countries around the world. You can still ask questions about what the level of donor risk is that is acceptable at a societal level or at a clinical level, and for that matter, what level of recipient benefit or lack of recipient benefit would move you against doing the procedure.
Okay. I know John Renz had a question. John?
Oh, you got to have this, John. No, this goes to the micro. This goes to the video. So it's not a matter of making your voice louder, which we know is plenty.
Yeah. So, you know, the problem I have with double equipoise is it's so beautiful on slides, yet so dirty in the way it's done in the United States. You know, double equipoise needs that private gift thing. But in reality, we all know that's not true. We know that the adult-to-adult living donors that go bad will be rescued at all costs from the CAD pool. And the donors, which never came up in the talk, they've been transplanted too. As a matter of fact, more donors have been transplanted to save their lives than recipient deaths have been. And if you added up all the donors, recipients who needed a CAD, plus the donors that were saved to transplant life, it varies your numbers dramatically. And the problem I have, not so much with that, because I think when we're in criteria, that's totally fine. But when you're out of criteria, The reality of the situation is that when living donors go bad, it's judged in the court of public opinion far before the facts are known. Mm-hmm. And we don't have any control over the court of public opinion. And we see what the court of public opinion did to the LD in Mount Sinai and, you know, decreased it by a third or what have you. We've never looked to see what the impact of bad LD press is on the overall consensus of CAD consent and conversion, which is our bread and butter. Mm-hmm. At present, there's only 250, maybe top LD in the world. If
in
those,
the US.
Yeah, in the US, if that change is even the smallest percent, because the N in cadaver donation is so great, it wipes all any kind of potential advantage out. And until those things are done, I just don't accept double equipoise outside of transplantation for patients who meet regularly accepted criteria, which mm-hmm. I think is totally appropriate. Because we can't, and you know, once we're labeled as cowboys, whether I bring in a 100-year-old liver or, you know, I mean, if I do enough and they die, I'll be labeled a cowboy. And that will hurt cadaveric donation mm-hmm. in Chicago, irrespective, just because I'm deemed, irresponsible. This happened, these are shared quantities. I think that's the problem with double equipoise. And in Europe, they sign contracts
right.
for only one.
I happen to agree with you. In our program, we will only consider for live donors, even if somebody's got 10 live donors. If they're within UCSF, able to be downstaged to within Milan and stay there for 3 months, that'll get you a cadaveric organ in region 5. So that's still acceptable. So we will not, you know, do a live donor in a setting of outside what's expanded acceptable in different areas of this country, because I happen to agree with you. I think it impacts everybody, and a bad outcome in a donor has tremendous impact that we can't even begin to quantify.
So we're once again over our hour, and thank Liz very much.